Amen. Welcome out to the house of God tonight. Let's take our seats. Lift up our voices with this song. For all you've done. See my Savior Redeemer. My Savior Redeemer lifted me from the miry clay. Almighty, forever, I will never be the same, 'cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son. My Savior, Redeemer, lifted me from the miry clay. Almighty, forever, I will never be the same, 'cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son. Sing you live. Yes, you lived and you died and you rose again on high. You opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for all you've done. Yes, you lived. Only Son, 'cause you came near from the everlasting to the world we live, the Father's only Son. And you lived, you died, you rose again on high. You opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for all you've done. Yes, you lived and you lived and you died and you rose again on high. You opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for all you've done. Let's stand to our feet across the house of God tonight. Continue to exalt his name, clap our hands, lift our voices as we sing this song, Our God.
Our God is greater. and temptations. We Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's giving us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. Let the lost be found, and the dead be raised in the here and now. Let love invade, let the church live aloud. Our God will say, we believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail. For the power of God has joined the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. And He's giving us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. Yet He's coming back. Saying we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit.
Pray tonight, church. We want to lift up a number of people. We want to pray for Crystal, needs salvation and needs God to intervene in her life. Also for Oliver Walsh, want to believe God for salvation, healing in this young man's life as well. We're going to lift up these pastors on the screen tonight. We want to pray for them and believe God for them. Obviously, the new ones are there. They just finished revival with Evangelist Gabriel, themselves, and God really did help them there. A number of people, great contacts, converts. I want to lift them up before God tonight. Hallelujah. I wonder this evening how many came to church this tonight. You have a personal need in your life. You'd signify that with a hand lifted, with a heart of faith. Hallelujah. We're going to pray, lift our voices before God, and I'm going to ask Val if you'll come and open this service in prayer tonight as we subside. Let's begin to pray, saints. Let's cry out to God in this place. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you tonight. Oh, God, move by the presence.
Heavenly Father, we thank you. And Father, we're able to come before your throne of grace this evening, Lord God. We lift up our knees before you, Lord God. You move wonderfully in our lives. We pray, God. We pray for Crystal, my God. Minister to Crystal's needs. We pray, minister, intervene in her situation, Lord. We pray for Oliver Walsh, Father God. We speak healing, recovery to Oliver, Lord God. We praise you and thank you, God. We pray, Father, Lord God, for these pastors, Lord, in New South Wales, for Pastor Huang, Lord God, and the pastors there, Lord God. Your grace upon the congregations there, Lord God, that they will serve you with zeal and passion and joy of a Holy Ghost, my God. Bring revival to their lives, we pray, Father, Lord God. We pray, Father, Lord God, for the service this evening, my Lord God, that you administer your anointing upon Pastor Plummer as he ministers to our lives. Our hearts be prepared, Lord, to receive your word, we pray, my God. We thank you, God, for all that you're doing in our midst. We pray for our new converts, God. We pray, Father, those that responded to the revival meetings. We pray, continue to move in their lives, my God. Show yourself strong in their lives, my God. Make yourself real, Lord, I pray, God. We thank you, Lord, God. We praise you and worship you. Let's just praise and worship God together this evening. Praise you, Father. Glorify your wonderful, glorious, and precious name, Almighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Just spend your time to greet one another.
Tonight here in the Potter's House this Wednesday night, amen. So good to be in church in the presence of God, amen. Number of things just to make mention of. Tomorrow through to Saturday morning, the building's open for morning prayer from 7 till 8 a.m. And invite you to come out. You're welcome to come out, find a place to pray and lay a hold of God each day. On Saturday, we'll be having men's breakfast straight after prayer, and then of course moving on from there, we'll be having some outreach right on 11 o'clock down at Casuarina. Moving on into the weekend, Sunday 9:30 a.m. we're going to be starting a new adult Bible hour series, and this is entitled Living in Prosperity, and we're going to be looking at some of the spiritual realities of poverty, breaking some of those curses perhaps, and then some practical realities as well of budgeting and getting ahead, living ahead, amen, and believing God for some great truths either to be reminded of or fresh revelation to come as well. But that'll be Sunday 9:30, looking forward to that, Living in Prosperity. Then at 10:30 a.m. we start our morning service, and of course 6 p.m. in the evening is our evening service as well. Praise God. Just to let you know, we do have the water baptism coming up as well. That originally was the 28th, but there's going to be some folks away at a very special wedding, and so we're going to be postponing that. Looking forward to that. We'll clarify the dates in the coming days. Hallelujah. Amen. That's all the announcements we have, church. We're going to have an offering right now. Let's give God praise as our ushers come. Thank God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for your grace and your presence. Amen. I really do love the scripture, and I love the complete Jewish Bible translation, actually, which says a person's gift clears his way and gives him access to the great. And that is reality. That is true this morning. Amen. Our tithes, our offerings, our gifts, they really do bring us into, in many respects, as a part of our worship. Amen. There's a reason we have song service, and then we have, of course, praise and worship. We pray, and then what? Then we bring an offering to God. It is a part of our worship service, and it really does many, many times bring us into the presence of God. This act of understanding God, you are first, you are number one, and we worship you. Hallelujah. We're going to give tonight. God bless you as you do, and I'm going to ask Liam if he'd lift his voice and pray. God bless you tonight as you give. Amen.
Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Save and cleanse me, turn my life around. Yeah.
1 Kings chapter 19. Tonight, 1 Kings chapter 19, we're going to read the first four verses only, very familiar scripture we'll get to in a moment. And as mentioned just a couple of weeks ago, we began a series on the topic of, or the struggle of, if you will, of insecurity. And so we're going to, the first one we looked at was that of comparisons or curse of comparisons. And some of the struggles that come along with insecurity and why people function the way that they do. We want to move on from that particular wrinkle of insecurity and look at a different one tonight. And perhaps by way of introduction, I was reading about English explorer William Perry. This was from the 1800s. This man was actually the man who mapped out the majority of the North Pole. And I was reading about one particular expedition where Perry and his crew were preparing to hike to a specific location. And so the night before they left, as many explorers would do in the 1800s, they studied the stars. And so here is this man, you can picture him, he's studying the stars. He's determining their exact coordinates, exactly where they were located on planet Earth by, again, looking at the stars, noting their location. The next morning, they began a difficult journey north. It was, an entire day going into a completely unmapped region. They marched through the snow and ice all day. And then as the sun set, they stopped. They began to set up camp, ate something. And when night set in, again, Perry studied the stars again to determine their exact coordinates. And this man was stunned to learn that even though they had walked north all day, now they somehow were further south when they began that morning. And after struggling to figure this out, they discovered that although they had, in fact, traveled north, they actually were on a giant sheet of ice that was floating south faster than they were walking north. And although they were going in the right direction, they were sliding away and didn't realize it. And I thought a bit about that story, and one of the thoughts that came to mind was I believe this has some common ground with the frustration of condemnation. It is possible to put in all kinds of effort. It is possible to legitimately, spiritually cover a lot of ground. It's possible to make a whole lot of progress. And yet, when a person is hampered by condemnation, it is possible to put in all this effort and gain all kinds of ground and yet pillow your head at night and consider your location. And perhaps it's a lie tonight, but the lie is, I'm no further along than from where I began. And walking in condemnation can be just like that. I read this quote this week that said, the moment you ask for forgiveness, God forgave you. Now do your part and leave the guilt behind. I want to read our scripture tonight. I want to preach a sermon, The Cure for Condemnation. And we're going to read 1 Kings 19. 1-4, familiar scripture. Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, also how he had executed all of the prophets with the sword. And Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so let the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. When he saw that, he arose and ran for his life and went to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, left his servant there, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, came, sat down under a broom tree, and he prayed that he might die and said, it is enough now, Lord, take my life, for I am no better than my father's. The cure for condemnation. Let's consider firstly, understanding condemnation. Someone made this quote. They said the Pharisees could only try and bring people to right living through condemnation. But Jesus drew people to righteousness through mercy and grace. You see, when it comes to condemnation, we soon realize that there are a couple of ways that this can manifest. Number one, it manifests or it comes from other people. In the Bible, it was the Pharisees that brought this condemnation. Or number two, it can come from within. And the fact is, both are demonically inspired or perhaps even initiated or instigated. But we can see these two areas where this comes from tonight. Firstly, the Bible has an account of some people that were the condemners. John chapter 8 speaks about the Pharisees. It speaks about the woman caught in the very act of adultery and how these Pharisees, they catch her, they drag her before Jesus. They drag her, they want her to be judged, they want her to be condemned. And Jesus, maybe you remember the story, as he looks at these Pharisees and he says, "He who is without sin, cast the first stone," writing in the sand. They all begin to walk away. Jesus turns to this woman and asks her the question, "Where are these accusers of yours?" She says, "There are none." And then Jesus says these profound words. He says, "Neither do I condemn you, go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn you." So what is condemnation then? If Jesus is saying, he's trying to say, well, they were condemning, but now they're not. They wanted me to condemn, but I'm not going. That's essentially what he's saying. So what does condemnation mean? In its essence, it means to be judged before your time. That's what condemnation actually means, to be judged or to judge before your time. This is what Jesus is saying. That's the spirit of the encounter here with this woman. The fact is, we all will be judged, and yet God is merciful. Though he judges, it is done in the light of the blood of Jesus and the forgiveness of his cross, and it won't be before the appointed time. See, condemnation is more than a feeling. By definition, condemnation is the expression of a very strong disapproval or even damnation. That's a heavy word. Damnation, that's a heavy word. In other words, it's not just words that are spoken or vibes from somebody or even just a spirit. It's actually more than that. The issue to condemn is to prejudge, or damnation. Condemnation tonight is laced with hopelessness. It can come to us demonically inspired by others. No doubt it can come from directly from hell as well. But think about our scripture, because here is Elijah. And Elijah's experience is from the place where Elijah's issue was self-condemnation, condemns himself. And if you dial it back, the reason he's going through this, 1 Kings 18, the prophets of Baal, maybe you remember the showdown, God is answering his prayers, fire is falling from the sky, the wicked are being judged. He speaks to the children of Israel, "Choose you this day." He's playing his part in getting the backslidden children of Israel to repent and to turn back to God. The nation doesn't immediately repent, and so he blames himself. He condemns himself. Because this ministry didn't work out how I thought, because the circumstances didn't unfold how I thought they were going to, and therefore, I'm no better than my fathers. My fathers got us into this mess, and I can't get the nation out of it. But how many know today it's not his job to make every person repent? If that was our job, we're all in trouble. Listen, that's between the people and God. We do have a responsibility. That is to preach the gospel. That is to present Christ with our testimony as best as possible. But at the end of the day, salvation is between a person and God. And yet, here he is. He's judged himself. That's what condemnation is. It's incorrectly judging. You ever felt despair that comes with condemnation? The sense of hopelessness, the sense of the thought of, well, that's it. What now then? Hopelessness.
many times it's not real, but it lines up with the idea that condemnation is about prejudging, judging before the time, passing judgment too early, or even damnation. There's a sentence that's attached. There's finality that comes with it, which is why people can draw the conclusion, well, what now then? So as we move forward, let's consider again this definition, condemnation, the judgmental attitude of yourself and others, which results in self-pity or even self-conceit. Let me talk for a minute about some of the facilitators of condemnation. I said before that condemnation has this spiritual element to it. Regardless of whether it comes from ourselves or from others, there is a demonic edge. However, I do believe there can be some open doors. There can be some things that we can leave open. There can be access points. This is not necessarily any specific or biblical order, but number one, an access point to condemnation, I believe, is that of insecurity. Insecure people, people that are not confident in them, in their life and in their God, people that are insecure are absolutely susceptible to condemnation and all of its internal and emotional turmoil that comes along with it, the wrestling that comes along with it. We're not going to spend long on this thought tonight, but I wonder if we could pause on that for a moment. Insecure people, there is often an intense susceptibility to being condemned or to condemnation. Blaming yourself, judging yourself, allowing others to pass judgment upon them. To bring that term into a spiritual arena, deep insecurity is probably due to a lack of faith. Lack of faith in how God views you. Lack of faith in the fact that God is a Father who loves you. That can absolutely play out in our insecurities, and therefore the devil can have a foothold. There's a second truth, and that is a second access point, and that is self-pity. Self or selfishness, self-focused, vanity, flesh, summarized by using the term self-pity, feeling sorry for ourselves. So easily, this place that we can live and wallow in sometimes so easily allows the devil to segue us into condemnation in our mind. In many ways, this is Elijah in our scripture. He is this man, at least in this moment, he's riddled with self-pity. Self-pity. This is understanding condemnation. We are body, soul, and spirit. We are flesh, and we are spirit this evening, of course, and we're soul as well. We have all of this going on, and all of this can begin to segue, mesh together, and yet we do need to understand condemnation within ourselves. Let me talk secondly about the aim of condemnation. An interesting article that I came across, this was from 2013, and this, the headline was Living Ohio Man Donald Miller Ruled Legally Dead. Let me read that again. Living Ohio Man Donald Miller Ruled Legally Dead. And what had happened, this man was declared dead after he disappeared 30 years before. Now he returned home. The law said he can't be declared officially alive. Confusing scenario for this man. Donald Miller of Ohio left behind a wife, two children, and significant debt when he fled his home in 1986. He was declared legally dead in 1994 and reemerged in 2005 attempting to apply for a driver's license. Judge found death rulings cannot be overturned after 3 years. I guess that's how long it takes to realize, you know. Judge Ellen Davis said, I don't know where that leaves you, but you're still deceased as far as the law is concerned. When pressed on as to why he disappeared, Mr. Miller said, I was under pressure and took off. Kind of went further than I expected it to. I just kind of took off and ended up in different places. Here's a guy who's wrestling with some stuff, so he just flees his responsibilities. And like always, listen, the devil has a vested interest in condemning people, putting them under spiritual pressure. Because the aim of condemnation ultimately is to cause people to do the same thing that Elijah did, the same thing this man did, and that is to withdraw. See, a first reality would be that people function under pressure, then under guilt. They function, but they're not free. A second response eventually is to withdraw or to pull back or to pull away. Again, look at Elijah, look at the scripture. No doubt there's some fear involved. There's some demonic and some perhaps some torment that's involved. But the other issue he repeats, I'm no better than my fathers. That's his issue. That's what he tells God. I'm no better than those who've been before. I'm no better than this. I'm no better than that. Was it true? No, it wasn't true. Condemnation never tells the truth. Many times it's a lie from hell. It's pre-judgment. It's shutting the door before it's over. Comes with hopelessness. What do we read? Where is he? 1 Kings 19. He takes off. God speaks to him, asks him the question, what are you doing here? In other words, this is not where he was supposed to be. He's not in the will of God at that point in time. He's pulled back. He's off course. He's out of the will of God. But that is always the devil's intention. That is the aim that he takes. That is the result he's looking for. For you and I to take our focus off what God told us to do and to put our focus on your inabilities. That was Elijah's problem. I am no better than my father. It wasn't about him. But the result of that focus is he finds himself off course. Not confident in himself, condemnation comes in. This is where he finds himself. This opening illustration, these men, the North Pole, they find themselves not where they should have been. They walked, they put in effort, they tried. But everything had to do with the foundation that they were on. When our foundation is guilt, when our view of God is that he is harsh even, when the foundation of our lives is our effort, the foundation of our lives is condemnation. Many people live trying to appease a lie. And we can find ourselves off course. The aim of condemnation is to cause people to withdraw and pull back. That is what the enemy is after. Let's go one step further because that leads us places. One of those places that condemnation will lead a person, ultimately it's true of insecurity, is isolation. Now we get further and further away. We see it in our scripture again. He finds himself far away. He leaves the place he's supposed to be. He goes a day's journey. He leaves his servant. He goes even further. He's in the desert. This is a wilderness experience. Far away, verse 10, he comes out with the classic statement, I alone am left. He's isolated himself. And it wasn't true, but condemnation leads to this last sense of isolation. Think with me about Elijah's friendship group. You know, 1 Kings 18, this is one chapter before our scripture. The Bible says that a godly man whose name is Obadiah comes, and Obadiah actually risks his life to save 100 true prophets, and he tells Elijah that. They actually have a conversation. He tells Elijah that. In other words, like, you weren't the only one. You literally weren't the only, but this is what he thinks in his mind. Elijah has just finished speaking with godly Obadiah. Then he's on the run. The next thing we read is he's complaining to God, and God responds, I have 7,000 who haven't bowed their knee to this wicked king. It's not true. The issue rarely is the issue. I've never heard that before. The issue is not the issue. So often that is true. The issue wasn't the issue. The fact was he had isolated himself. The saddest reality is we have the capacity actually to do this to ourselves. Every person, we can condemn ourselves. We have the capacity to prejudge. Literally, people have the ability to just close the door to the arena before the game's finished. People have the ability to judge before the proper time in their own life. No longer allowing ourselves to go on. Someone said it this way: we put a full stop when God puts a comma. God's not finished writing the book of our lives, the chapters of our lives. We can allow Satan to so infiltrate, allowing things to go on in our own self. Listen, what a demonic strategy tonight. Yes, we're all going to stand before God on that great and awesome day. Jesus comes, there will be a judgment. But for the born-again believer, all that judgment for sin and failure, etc., is going to be on Christ. And until that day, I love what James says in James 4:12. He says, there is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who are you to judge another? That includes us. I love Paul the Apostle, 1 Corinthians 4:3-5, but to me, he says, it's a very small thing that I should be examined or critiqued by you or by any human court. He says, in fact, I don't even examine myself. That's interesting. He says, for I am conscious of nothing against myself, yet I am not by this acquitted, but the one who examines me is the Lord. Therefore, don't go on passing judgment before the time, but wait until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the things hidden in the darkness and disclose the motives of men's hearts. Then each man's praise will come from God. Condemnation, it's real, it's spiritual, it's a weapon of the enemy that we can allow to blind us, affect us, and pull us away. And there, this is, you don't want to give the devil too many props, but this is actually a masterful strategy that he employs. We are not to be ignorant of his devices, because this is a reality tonight of condemnation. It's the aim of condemnation, to take people away from the will of God. Let me close by talking about the answer. The fact is, there is an answer tonight. In some ways, yes, it requires humility, but the answer actually is quite simple. If we look purely at our scripture, according to the text, God's answer for Elijah was godly friends. Elijah has his self-pity. I'm the only one, just kill me, etc. God doesn't respond to his emotions and feelings. God doesn't give him, you know, some little back rub or shoulder massage, but it was just simply, you know what you need to do. And what it is, the first place he comes to before he gets to the friend's part, he says, get up and eat some food. That's good doctrine. It really is. You know, our emotions can be so fickle sometimes. We can be going through all kinds of things and you go have a good meal and it's like, oh man, life's going to be all right. Tell me it's not true. It is true many times. 1 Kings 19:4, he himself, when a day's journey into the wilderness came, sat down under the broom tree, prayed he might die, said, it's enough, take my life, Lord, I'm no better than my father's. Then as he lay and slept under a broom tree, suddenly an angel touched him and said to him, arise and eat. There is a this is human emotion we're talking about right here. There is something to be said about just how we feel about life. In many ways, just the simplicity of life has the ability to help us in our spirit and how we feel. From there, God says, go and get some godly friends. 1 Kings 19:15, then the Lord said to him, go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, anoint Hazael as the king over Syria. You shall also anoint Jehu as king over Israel, and Elisha you shall anoint as prophet in your place. It shall be that whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, Jehu will kill. Whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, Elisha will kill. Elijah, go and get these men. Their names have meanings. Jehu means Jehovah is He. Hazael means God sees. Elisha means God is salvation. God's response, Elijah's gets some godly friends. His response to this man's insecurity, if you will, and condemnation, all of his wrestling, the isolation that came along with it, was connect yourself to some men of God who will speak. Why? Because godly friends speak truth. Godly friends bring clarity. Godly friends, the whole point of this is that some people who are going to have your back in a spiritual arena. That's what he says. Whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, Jehu's going to kill. Whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, Elisha's going to come along and take care of business. There are some godly people in your life that can help you take care of business and speak the truth. I was talking to a man a while back, and I know this man's brother from many, many years ago. And got talking with him. This guy is not a Christian by any means, but he tells me that his wife is, especially at the time they got involved in a church over east somewhere. And here's this guy. He's not saved. Wife goes to a church. He did get involved in trying to help out with some of the people that were struggling in the area. Just, you know, it's not exactly what every church does, but this is what they were doing. And he just began to help and try and do something. And he began to tell me about the power. Think about this man. He's not saved. He's just trying to help out some people. Good-hearted man. He begins to tell me about the power of fellowship. Not even saved. But he had a revelation about the sanity that comes when people have a friend and will begin to open their heart a little bit and begin to talk and begin to, in some ways, do life together. It's the power of fellowship. It's the power of a true friend. Isn't that what insecurity wars against? I want to open up, have all these feelings and thoughts and concepts about ourselves. Either they come from hell or they come from within. But the power of a true friend, the power of an honest conversation, it blows the webs off of discouragement. The lies of condemnation. Fellowship is designed by God to bring the light of truth. Truth. John 8:32, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The truth sets people free, and the hope and the belief is that godly friends will tell you the truth. Do you have tonight godly friends? Do you have that? That is a genuine question. Do you have godly friends? People that perhaps can be in the trenches with you and yet will speak the truth. People that when you open your heart and begin to share, sometimes you catch your words and think, that sounds a bit crazy even just saying it, but I hope they tell me that's true. Hope they speak the truth. What about a focus on fellowship? Proverbs 27, 5 and 6, open rebuke is better than love carefully concealed. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. Not the words of a friend, the wounds of a friend. Sometimes the truth hurts. Sometimes the truth is difficult sometimes, but oftentimes it's soothing and relaxing as well. But the truth is faithful to deliver and to clarify. I heard a friend, the testimony one time about a guy had a good old pity party to his friend, just opening his heart. So, you know, we say whinge, don't we? Had a whinge to his friend. You have a true friend if you can have a whinge to them. And especially when they respond with truth. And this friend responded to this other guy, said, well, sounds after he listened to him pour his heart out a bit, he realized this is just a good old-fashioned complaining. Sounds to me like you need to draw a circle in your office, get on your face, and don't leave the circle till you find God. That's what that friend needed to hear. And this guy said it felt a little harsh at the time, but it was a divine slap. The friend saw right through everything this other guy was going through and just, this is what you need God to speak to you. Find God. Blew the cobwebs out. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. What is needed is truth. How did Elijah get free? He had to have some godly friends who would speak the truth. You know, to get those friends, what did he have to do? He had to get out of himself, didn't he? He had to go back on course, and you know, he'd always been the Lone Ranger. That was Elijah. He'd always been the Lone Ranger to that point. But Lone Rangers are just that tonight. They're lonely. Oftentimes they live inside their own head. Sometimes they struggle with condemnation as a result. And to get these friends, he had to actively go out and find them. Maybe tonight that's direction from God for somebody. You struggle with condemnation. There's insecurities and there is issues and different things, but you're lonely. But it's because of self-isolation. And the answer tonight is get some godly friends. You have to trust somebody. Understand, trust can be broken. It can be hard to open up again. It can be hard to trust again. But beloved, listen, you have to trust somebody. Because Lone Rangers, they wrestle. Elijah, this incredible man of God, wrestling, finding himself in a cave on the run, running from some woman. Why? Because he didn't trust anybody. And God said, this is the problem. You have to open your heart. You have to have some friends. Maybe you already do. Maybe that's not you tonight and you already do, but perhaps fellowship has dried up and it's been a little while. Not because anything evil, sometimes we just get busy, etc. But you can see the lies of the devil beginning to creep back in. Maybe God would remind you tonight, fellowship is a healthy thing. Sitting with brothers, sitting with sisters, talking across the table, friends in the things of God, and beginning to share and open your heart, somebody that you trust. You need fellowship. Hallelujah. Let me close tonight. Silas Robertson, affectionately known as Uncle Si to the Duck Dynasty viewers, sometimes writes down John 3, 16 and 17. You know the Duck Dynasty? Nah, some do. Google it later. It's interesting. I think it's safe. It'd probably be fine. But he sometimes, when he's signing autographs, he will write down John 3, 16 and 17. And he said in an interview, he said, most people can tell you what verse 16 says. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, etc. He said, but they don't know nothing about 17. And it says, Jesus didn't come to condemn us. He went on and said, if anyone had the right to condemn someone, it would be the Son of God. But if he didn't do it, then, hey, we definitely are not qualified to do it. That's true of others that try to condemn us. That's true of hell that comes against us. That's true of our own heart. And the Son did not come to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. Get tonight some godly friends and get the truth. Hallelujah. Let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes tonight. Thank God for his word. Condemnation. Reality is many times all people need is a little bit of encouragement. It's going to be okay. Pick yourself up. Let's walk forward. No, it's not true. Feel that way. Yeah, maybe some truth. Maybe God's directing you because he wants to help you. But many times, no. No, a lot of things are lies from hell. Sent to hinder, sent to push you back, sent to frustrate, ultimately sent, just like Elijah, to push you off course. Where does that condemnation come from? You know the difference between conviction and condemnation? Conviction draws you to God. There's hope. There's love. There's kindness. There's grace. There's a way out. There's freedom. But condemnation has a dead end. Hopeless, there's despair. There's no future. It's from hell, it's condemnation. Tonight, I understand we're segueing from insecurity into that, but the reality is people that don't know their God are not confident in their God. Faith is struggling in their God. Many times they become susceptible to condemnation. God wants to help some people tonight. Begin to think about these things. Maybe we don't think ourselves as insecure people, but begin to realize, hey, I feel condemnation all the time and I let it sit in my spirit because I don't who are confident in God. Get some godly friends. People that will help you keep balance. So often I said, no, these things are not true. Someone that will fight for you in a spiritual arena. Hallelujah. Here tonight, we're going to pray just a moment of time, but maybe you came to church tonight, you're not saved, or maybe backslidden. You know that you need to pray, you want to get right with God, and you want to pray tonight. I want to ask you to lift up your hand. Unsaved or backslidden, you know you need to pray, you need to get right with God. Quickly lift up your hand. All over this place, how many would there be? I tell you, God died for sinners. God loves people. Jesus Christ came to this earth. He poured out his blood upon Calvary's cross so that he could set people free. His inaugural speech in the book of Luke said that I have come to set people free. I'm paraphrasing, but you can go and read that. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Anointed me, preach the gospel to the poor, open the eyes of the blind. I've come to set people free. Here tonight, you're not right with God. You need to pray quickly. We're in the presence of God. He wants to minister to you. He wants to forgive your sin. Unsaved or backslidden, you need to pray quickly. Lift up your hand. God loves you. God loves you. He wants to forgive sin. He wishes none should perish. All should have eternal life. One more call, unsaved or backslidden. God's touching your heart right now. You need to pray. Prayer of repentance. Lift up your hand. Thank God. I sense the presence of God here. I sense the presence of God. And changing the call. Condemnation is something that perhaps none of us are stranger to. Some, you wake up, the devil's knocking on your door. Others, you go about your day, and he comes right in. You're not good enough. You haven't done enough. You're this, you're that, whatever it is. And it's just condemnation. And you can tell it is because it's always the same. It's not like, gee, I really do need to change in some areas and thank God he's going to help me. It's not that at all. It's just prejudged. It has an end. It's a dead end. Hopelessness, perhaps. Despair even. And it's from hell. And I believe that's why God's answer for Elijah was no, you need some company. You need some people around you that share the truth and speak the truth. Clarify, maybe speak into your life, or maybe they're just there, and because they're there, sanity prevails. I love the words of this man mentioned at the end, Silas Robertson, verse 17 of John chapter 3. If Jesus didn't come to condemn us and is the only one who had a right to condemn, if he didn't do it, then we're not qualified. That's true of us. That's true of hell. And tonight we can come to this place. Place of revelation afresh. Be set free of condemnation. Live in free. You'll know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. The presence of God is here tonight in this place. I love Wednesday nights. I love the presence of God. What a joy. We're going to pray that tonight. This altar is open. Let's all stand to our feet this evening. Amen. Let's come find a place to pray. I feel God in this place tonight. He's helping people. Come find a place to pray. We may not think of ourselves really as that insecure, but here is this man, absolutely condemnation. Why? Because he didn't have those around him, because he's wrestling in his relationship with God. He's wrestling within himself. No better than my father's, it wasn't true. It was from hell. Thank God. Let's pray today. Let's come to this altar. Dale's going to help us to sing, to worship God tonight. But let's cry out to God in this place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Siara madama yerebesi. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Orda basando roboseto roboki. I worship and magnify your name. Your name. Oh, hallelujah. Call out to the Lord in this place. And hallowed be your Abbas. Baramare meki. Yarabarda basante. Thank you. You know, the reality is, and this is probably true of a lot of people, is we can go through certain elements of life where we really can come to the place at different times. We think to ourselves this very statement, I'm just not good enough. And when I said that tonight, even in the sermon, it began to resonate with certain people and some hearts. I'm not good enough. I haven't done enough. You know, fill in the blank. I haven't given enough. I haven't tried hard enough. But where does that stop? If we're always just functioning like that, trying to somehow make up the ground between what? For goodness? That we would be better? That, you know, I'm sure, yeah, sure, we got to pursue holiness and live for God. We understand that. But at what point do we realize we're never going to be good enough in that sense? No, Jesus, He bled and He died on Calvary's cross to forgive and to redeem. Not so that we would be condemned and beat ourselves up, but so that we would simply understand your value. Can you do that tonight for a moment of time? Understand your value. His blood. The only time God ever became a man, went to a cross. Let the Spirit of God minister you to right at this altar today. Went to a cross, willingly, whipped, beaten, hung there, and died. And then consider your value for a moment, because that's your value. That's literally what the Word of God is talking about. That is your value. I am not. Can we stop that and realize? This is true for all people. How much are you worth? Well, look at the cross. Look at the cross. Some women here, you wrestle. I'm not of high value. I'm not worth that. I haven't done enough. I'm not good enough. And it's like, you know what? It's not true. It's condemnation. It's a life from hell. When are you ever going to have done enough to be? It's not true. And what is true is to realize, no, I need some godly friends just to talk to and gain sanity and realize. You ever feel like that? Listen, look to the cross, because that's your worth. That's true for all people. Hallelujah. Amen. Can we sing that song one more time? We've got a few minutes now. Let's sing that song. Sing it out tonight. What a God we serve. Just be in His presence. Just worship His name. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallowed be.
Sing it out. Hallelujah.
Lord.
tonight in a word of prayer. One more thought, though, and that very simply is this. Don't do the devil's work for him. He's good enough as his job as it is without you and I beating ourselves. Don't do the devil's job for him. I believe God would rather people just, you know, have a little bit of an edge of confidence, and even if it borders on the edge of pride, he can take care of that. That's fine. Have faith. Believe God. No, God, you said this about my life. That's what I'm going to believe you for. And absolutely, this is who we are in Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to dismiss in prayer tonight. God bless you as we do. And we'll see you on the weekend. Looking forward to all that God has. And Len, if you lift your voice tonight, seal us in prayer. Yes.
We ask, Lord God, as we walk in this victory, Lord God.
Thank you.
God, may our eyes upon you and your love and your grace.
Yes.
God, we pray your blessing upon each and every one, Lord. We'll come back safely.
Amen. God bless you tonight, church. Appreciate it.